Welcome to Gospel Tangents, the best source for Mormon history, science, and theology. I'm Rick Bennett. Following the Kirtland banking crisis of 1838, many saints were disillusioned with Joseph Smith's leadership, including W.W. Phelps. In our next conversation with Phelps biographer, Dr. Bruce Van Orden, he's the author of We'll Sing and We'll Shout, The Life and Times of W.W. Phelps. We'll learn more about Phelps' disillusionment with Joseph, as well as Thomas B. Marsh setting his sights on W.W. Phelps to drive him out of the church. You won't want to miss this conversation. Check it out. Phelps is in Kirtland. This is right before the Kirtland banking crisis, I know. But he goes back to Missouri, and it seems like he had a problem with Marsh, right? Thomas Marsh?
It's a long story, and it's complicated, and it needs to be spoken of in context, and I believe so much in context, you can't take things out of context and understand them. Their assignment was to, the Missouri leadership of the church, was to go to the House of the Lord, receive that endowment, which we call the Kirtland Endowment, which involved washings and anointings, but a spiritual outpouring from heaven. The Spirit of God, like a fire is burning, is actually a depiction of the kinds of feelings of visions and heavenly manifestations that took place during this whole frame of time. Leading up to the dedication and the dedication itself. And we still know that that is the Hosanna anthem that is sung at every temple dedication ever since. The Spirit of God like a fire is burning, amen and amen, Hosanna to God in the Lamb, that whole enthusiasm.
Yeah.
But once that was over, the Missouri leadership, were assigned to go back. Well, they did. But no sooner had they arrived, Bishop Partridge and W.W. Phelps and John Whitmer, when they realized that the Clay County people wanted the Latter-day Saints out of their county now too, for much of the same reasons. They were just different. And there were more slave owners in Clay County than had been slave owners in Jackson County. Oh. And there were these frustrations. The big difference is they were willing to negotiate. They were not willing to enforce it by violence. They said, we insist you go. We'll work with you. We'll help you go. We'll help you find someplace else. But you must go. And if you don't go, the same type of thing might happen as happened back here. And there were some tense meetings. Phelps led the way in working out the arrangements. And he and Bishop Partridge went on two scouting expeditions in northern Missouri to find a new location for the Latter-day Saints to live. On the second scouting expedition, they found a fairly nice place along Shoal Creek. It wasn't a raging river or anything, but it did have water and some timber in an uninhabited, mostly uninhabited area north of Richmond in Ray County. It was still part of Ray County, but it was uninhabited. And with cooperation from the Clay County leadership, the Saints were able to get out and migrate over to Shoal Creek. And in the process of that, their lawyer and also the representative in the state legislature, Alexander Donovan, worked with Phelps and Partridge to create a Mormon county out of northern Ray County that would be just for the Latter-day Saints and nobody else. And what happened is the Latter-day Saints did buy out the very few inhabitants that lived on Shoal Creek and then established a town far west named by W.W. Phelps. He called it that. It was in the far west, and so he called it Far West. Unfortunately, in the negotiations in the Missouri State Legislature, the county didn't end up as big as they had hoped. It was supposed to include what later became also Davies County. It was Caldwell County, just north of Ray County. And then they called the new one Davies County because there were a few inhabitants there, not too many, maybe 300 or 400 was all in Davies County, but that remained an entity by itself. And so the Mormon County was restricted to this smaller area along Shoal Creek in Caldwell County. And it turned out that was too small for all the Latter-day Saints to inhabit, and not enough water resources and timber resources. And eventually Latter-day Saints spilled on up north to Daviess County, which started the Mormon-Missouri War of 1838. But you're right then that Phelps was a major player in establishing that new gathering place. He became so enthusiastic. Remember, he was always enthusiastic about the restoration items, the millennium coming soon, the Indians being restored to their proper place, temples. And we had just been there in the house of the Lord in Kirtland with all those spiritual outpourings. We're going to get a temple now in Far West, and he identified at the city headquarters in the middle of town where the temple would be laid out, and he laid it out and set it up all by himself. Well, not all by himself. It was in harmony with Bishop Partridge and John Whitmer. But then they were scolded later because Joseph Smith said, this is the prerogative of the first presidency to know when we build a temple, not you. You may be the presidency of the church in Missouri, which they still were, but it's the first presidency, which had been established by that time, that has that prerogative. So they end up having to stop that. But they had gathered funds. All sorts of funds had been obtained to buy land in this new gathering place by none other than Thomas Marsh. Now, Thomas Marsh was a member of the 12 Apostles, but we've got to remember that the 12 Apostles did not have authority over all the church at this point. They did not. That's right. So important to know.
Yeah, I think that's really hard for modern Latter-day Saints to understand, that the High Council and the Apostles were basically on equal levels. Is that
for sure? And from time to time, when the 12 Apostles were back in Kirtland and High Council proceedings took place, but not all 12 of the High Council members who had been designated as such were present, from time to time, members of the 12 Apostles sat in as ad hoc members of the High Council for High Council proceedings. The same thing then happened in Missouri. And I'll remember Thomas Marsh was actually an inhabitant of Missouri when he went to Ohio and got his commission to be an apostle. And then he went out with the other 12 apostles to the eastern United States and preached the gospel. But when the Kirtland Temple was dedicated and finished, he went to live back with his family in Missouri. And he became an ad hoc member of the High Council in Missouri under W.W. Phelps's presidency. And he and Elisha Groves, a regular member of the High Council, were assigned, the two of them, to go to Tennessee and obtain some monies from the Latter-day Saints to help poor bleeding Zion, being pushed out of Clay County, to reestablish themselves in a new place. And they came back with substantial monies. And he brought with him, Marsh did, David Patton, who was his good friend in the 12 Apostles. Patton and his wife were childless, and so they came together, brother and sister Patton, and Marsh came back to his family. And apparently they felt at this point that they should have authority over what was going on there because they had obtained the money. That was one reason. And I think that Marsh always wanted to be very important and to be a leader and to be recognized as such. He did have that egocentric driven way of doing things. And so they plotted together to try to get rid of Phelps and John Whitmer as the leadership. They held proceedings, illegal ones, according to the revelation that had been given about how courts were to be handled. They came into resistance from Bishop Partridge and some members of the High Council. So nothing was actually done there in 1837. And then Marsh and Patton went to Kirtland because they were assigned to go there to meet with all of the 12, where they would plan for the future. And Section 112 of the Doctrine and Covenants, which is directed to Thomas Marsh, president of the 12. He was president of the 12 simply because he was the oldest. Mm-hmm. That's the only reason.
Well, that was how they called by seniority,
yeah, right,
by age.
Yeah. For the original 12. But he was the president of the 12 because he was supposedly the oldest. And so Section 112, which outlines what 12 apostles do in taking the gospel to all the world. Well, they had this, and then Marsh and Patton stayed in Ohio for a while and got rid of some of the apostates that were coming forward as a result of this bank crisis and other apostate activities going on. There were lots of them. And four of the original 12 were cut off from the church under the direction of Joseph Smith with the aid of Thomas B. Marsh. Marsh was trying to say, I'm helping you clean up the place. And then he was assigned to go back to live in Missouri, where he didn't have any specific authority. But he took with him an admonition from Joseph Smith that Phelps and John Whitmer were doing some things in error. Well, what he had heard is that from Marsh, what Joseph Smith had heard from Marsh is that they were using these monies to buy up the property, and then they would carve out the property into lots in Far West, into square lots, and then sell them for a profit. But the money that was brought in as a result of the profit from selling these lots was to go to the temple. But Marsh didn't like the idea that these guys were in charge and he wasn't. And so when he got back to Missouri in late 1837 and then in 1838, he concocted another court, and this time had enough support from the High Council. And it wasn't presided over in the right way at all, but they excommunicated W.W. Phelps and John Whitmer and installed themselves as the presidency, the new presidency. Okay, we got rid of them. We're now the presidency. Thomas Marsh and David Patton.
So this is confusing.
It is confusing. It's complicated. But it was a power struggle. It was a coup. And by the way, Phelps was not perfect in his relationship. He shot back and had snide remarks and was a bit mischievous in his relationship then with Marsh at that point.
So let me make sure we understand. So essentially, the Whitmers and W.W. Phelps are leading the church. Marsh is an apostle and actually president of the 12 apostles, but they're not supposed to have authority where a high council exists. But so Marsh essentially usurped authority in Missouri and excommunicated Phelps and the Whitmers. Is that right?
He plotted, he and Patton both,
yeah,
plotted with members of the high council to undermine Phelps and Whitmer. Remember, David Whitmer's still in the East. So and by the time they finally held the proceedings, David Whitmer had returned, but they didn't excommunicate him because they felt that, Bishop Partrey says, you're doing this entirely illegally. A presidency needs to be, a court for them would be held by the bishopric, not by you guys. And according to the revelations, Partridge was right, but they went ahead and excommunicate those two anyway, with the High Council's approval. And this was, and he wanted to get it done before Joseph Smith arrived. And then when Joseph arrived, he says, see, I helped you clean out Ohio, and I've cleaned out Missouri, and now we're ready to have you just take over just right.
Okay. So Phelps, excuse me, Marsh basically cleaned out all the apostates
Marsh
in Kirtland.
And Patton together.
So now, all the people that were upset about the bank. So that would have been McClellan, probably. Is that right?
McClellan was the fifth one that ended up being lost.
Okay.
And then he was one of them. Boynton, Luke Johnson, Lyman Johnson.
Okay. So those were the Kirtland rabble-rousers.
There were others besides those four members of the 12.
Okay.
Yeah, okay, it was a whole group. And in fact, by this time, Oliver Cowdery had essentially lost his...
That was another issue. So essentially, Marsh is cleaning house in Kirtland, getting rid of the...
Helping to clean house. He helped Joseph Smith clean house there.
Okay.
And then when he got back to Missouri, he and Patton...
Did the same thing.
Worked with the members of the High Council and cleaned house again.
Okay. And so that got rid of Phelps. And so the charge was that Phelps was misusing money.
Yes.
Because in Phelps's mind, he was using this money as a fundraiser for the temple, but he wasn't authorized to make a temple.
All the monies and property of the church should have fallen under the bishopric. But when they started doing it, laying out the city, the bishopric hadn't moved on over yet, and so it was Phelps and John Whitmer who were doing it, and then they kept doing it, and they took authority that the bishopric should have had over the temporal affairs, and that was one of the charges, and it was a fair charge, but that was worked out. W.W. Phelps and John Whitmer handed over all of the business transactions and the monies and the property to the bishopric, and so that was solved, and yet still there was this power play.
Okay.
But it involved Cowdery and David Whitmer too, because by that time those two had, it was obvious that they were against Joseph Smith on several things pertaining to economics and free will and who should tell them what to do politically and this type of thing back in Ohio, and they arrived in Missouri, and Oliver Cowdery was poisoning the well when he arrived, saying Joseph Smith is doing some wrong things. Mm-hmm. And that influenced clearly Phelps and John Whitmer too.
So I want to talk about Cowdery in just a second. But so essentially what was happening was Marsh kind of made a power play to take over
and
in
Patton,
Missouri.
I want to emphasize
Marsh and
that.
Patton.
I realize that David W. Patton goes down as the first apostolic martyr of the church because he died in battle.
Captain Fear Not.
As if he were a great man all the way. And there were good things about him. He was a fantastic missionary. I'm not saying he was a totally bad guy. But when it came to this power play, he was a full partner with Thomas Marsh.
Okay.
Together, they did.
A lot of us always remember Thomas Marsh because of the milk and stripping story. And I don't think a lot of people know Patton very well.
No, they don't.
And so that's...
He became a Danite. Now, remember when Joseph Smith and Sidney Rigdon arrived finally in late March of 1838 to live in Far West, they were convinced by Marsh and Patton, and then by their own belief system, that they had to get rid of these dissidents. They called them the ones who are now opponents, dissidents, and they were named as Oliver Cowdery, David Whitmer, John Whitmer, W.W. Phelps, and Coral. And we got to get rid of all these guys. And the Danite band was formed secretively, and the leader, military wise speaking, was Captain Fear Not, David W. Patton, who was a Danite. And we now look at the Danites, of course, as an unfortunate development in our history because they performed depredations that were illegal in the Mormon-Missouri War that helped bring about the charges against Joseph Smith and Sidney Rigdon.
Yeah, yeah. So it was interesting to me because Marsh and Patton basically excommunicated Phelps and the Whitmers.
Yes.
But I didn't understand why they couldn't do that with Oliver Cowdery.
Well, he had been called to be the second ranking leader in the church. When he arrived in Ohio in late 1834, or in 1833 actually arrived, but in 1834 he was designated then as associate president.
Okay.
And he was second ranking. He ranked above Sidney Rigdon and Frederick G. Williams,
okay,
who were counselors in the first presidency. And according to Section 107, members of that presidency could only have proceedings against them by the bishopric. And Partridge knew this. And so Cowdery was not excommunicated by Marsh and Patton, and they said, we're going to wait on that. And they got Joseph Smith's and Sidney Rigdon's ear immediately upon their arrival, and proceedings were held immediately. And of course, Joseph Smith was very annoyed with Oliver Cowdery too for about five reasons, and then he was excommunicated at that point.
Because I know one of those, you know, there's the dirty, nasty, filthy affair or scrape or whatever you want to do with Fanny Alger. What are the other issues that Joseph was upset with Oliver about?
Well, it was more Oliver being upset with Joseph Smith over the banking episode.
Okay.
He was a full player in that, and then he felt that it was being mismanaged. And then Joseph Smith kept giving commands to Oliver Cowdery about what he should do with temporal affairs and also politically. And he felt, this is against the rule of law. We believe in freedom of opinion and freedom of choice when it comes to some of these things, and he became very recalcitrant to being directed by Joseph Smith in economic and political affairs, and so I was part of it.
Okay. And was he involved in any of the management of the monies in Missouri as well? I can't remember.
Well, he was involved in the exploration committees to find new places for settlement for the Latter-day Saints that they knew were going to come. But before he could fulfill those obligations, he was excommunicated. He wasn't part of those charges against Phelps and Whitmer.
Okay.
Okay. However, when he did arrive, he was very close friends with Phelps, very close. And then he was a member of the Whitmer family, having married into the Whitmer family.
Okay.
And was brothers with David Whitmer and John Whitmer and Jacob Whitmer and Peter Whitmer Jr. And his father-in-law was Peter Whitmer Sr. And so he was very much a Whitmer in many ways. And when he came, he brought all of these animosities that he felt towards Joseph Smith. And they got them all upset.
Okay. So they had a trial, a court case against Oliver.
And David Whitmer, too, at that point.
And David
and
Whitmer.
And Lyman Johnson and McClellan got excommunicated about that same time.
Oh, I was thinking McClellan was in Kirtland, but that's interesting.
He wasn't excommunicated until May of 1838. He was not one of those four. He became the fifth.
Okay. All right. I hope you enjoyed our conversation with Dr. Bruce Van Orden. In our next conversation, Bruce will tell us about his feelings about the Whitmer family. The Whitmers were early prominent figures in the Mormon movement.
I want to say that I feel really, really bad to this day and hour that the Whitmers were driven out of the church.
Mm-hmm.
We think of the Whitmers as early pioneers in the building of the kingdom of God. David Whitmer, John Whitmer, Peter Whitmer Sr., who hosted, Mary Whitmer, who had this other vision of Moroni, supposedly.
Right.
All of those fine people who had done so much were driven out of town, and not one of them came back.
If you'd like to hear the entire interview uncut, please subscribe for just $5 a month at patreon.com/gospeltangents, and you can hear the entire interview before everybody else. If you'd like to watch the entire video for just $8 a month, you can either subscribe on YouTube, Patreon, or my website, gospeltangents.com. Just click the yellow subscribe button, and I'll add you to our Gospel Tangents Insiders group so that you can see entire videos. For those interested in a PDF transcript, you can subscribe at either Patreon or on my website. For just $10 a month, I'll send you a PDF as soon as it's complete. If you'd like a copy of the paperback as well as a PDF, just sign up for $20 a month at either Patreon or my website, gospeltangents.com. Of course, you can buy individual transcripts at amazon.com and just do a search for Gospel Tangents Interview and you can see all the things that we have there. Don't forget to support Gospel Tangents with an awesome t-shirt like one of these. You can subscribe at Apple Podcasts at tinyurl.com/gospeltangents. Get our latest updates at facebook.com/gospeltangents. Also, you can get our Twitter updates at gospeltangents. Click here to subscribe, here for a transcript, and over here we've got more of our great videos. Thanks again.